afternoon. Hi, welcome to Cambia Grove. My name is Jessica Hoffler. I'm the Manager of Programs and Operations here. And I'm happy to welcome you to the last of our six-point series of the 5 points of healthcare. Cambia Grove's a healthcare innovation hub working to break down barriers in healthcare. And one of the first barriers that we found in healthcare is the disconnect between the traditional healthcare system and change makers trying to make a difference, whether you're a technology startup or a non-traditional provider. And so we developed this framework, the 5 points of healthcare, the patient, payer, provider, policymaker, and purchaser. And we determined those as the major stakeholders in the healthcare that make up the healthcare system. So we started in January with an overview of the whole system. We had all five P's on a panel. And then we took it month by month. And this is the purchaser panel. Thank you all for joining us. And on your seats, there's a survey. Thank you for coming to our last one. Now you get to give us feedback on how it all went. And there's also a flyer about our upcoming interoperability summit, June 20th and 21st, talking about a really important topic that comes up all throughout our panels. So without further ado, I'll get on with the show. And I'm happy to introduce our moderator for today, Anil Kumar. He's up from Portland. So Anil, take it away.
Jessica talked about, my name is Anil Kumar. We have a startup based off Oregon Bioscience Incubator. How many of you heard of OBI? Okay, few people here. Okay, so we are not in out there. Yeah, we have a platform that makes lab testing more accessible by providing people access to check for cholesterol and things like that by testing from home. So the platform allows somebody to order the test and collect the sample home and ship it out. So we are trying to take one barrier away from for people to test out. It's a platform called rxhometest.com. And that's one area that's slowly growing. So it's a startup in the digital health space. How about I make a quick check on the audience? Who works in a startup here? So about five, I see. And who works in a healthcare system in the 5 points that we have covered throughout this year? I see. And anybody in the benefits administration? The benefits administration. Okay. And anybody in the startup support community? Okay, a lot of Cambia folks. So I'll quickly go over the agenda, and then I'll talk about how do we get your questions answered. So for the first 30 minutes, we'll get the perspective from our panelists here. They will introduce themselves and talk about the innovations part of their work. And then the next 45 minutes, we'll take one aspect for each panelist and talk about the details. In the last 10 minutes or so, we will have the final discussion around the Q&A. Jessica, do we have a link? Yeah, it's right here. The green second last row you see, the poll everywhere. You can go online and write your questions on that website, and it will pop up here on the screen, and then if your question is already there, it'll pop up in here, and you can thumb up, and the question will go up, and I'll take the questions that way. So it'll help us track the most commonly asked questions. So the link is right there, pollev.com/CambiaGrove191. Okay, so let's come back to our panelists. Do you want to introduce yourself one by one?
Yeah. So I'm Marissa Clyde. I am the managing director for the SEIU 775 Health Benefits Trust. We are purchasers on behalf of about 20,000 home care aides, so caregivers who are caring for primarily Medicaid clients in their homes. We then purchase wraparound benefits, so an EAP program and some behavioral health services for an additional 30,000 people. We're purchasing on behalf of our members throughout the state of Washington. I think that we're a little bit unique because we are a Taft-Hartley Trust, so we're a labor management partnership, so we are not an employer, yet we are purchasing benefits on behalf of our members. Our population is also unique. It's a population that has a history of little or no health insurance, and they are primarily, there's a high prevalence of chronic conditions. Almost half of the people have at least one chronic condition. Many have multiple chronic conditions. 83% women, an average age of about 48. So it's a very unique population and a population that often experiences a lot of disparities in healthcare. So we really see the role of the purchaser, especially in healthcare and innovation, to engage with the delivery system and really advocate on behalf of our members to make sure that they have access to equitable care, and that they can really get the care that they need. So we engage with the delivery system, we engage with our carrier partners, and then we pilot our own internal programs to address any unmet need. So we really look at equity as a core value and making sure that we can measure our results and that we are providing benefits that are measurable, that are having an impact. And sometimes those are a little bit out of the box for your traditional delivery system, but it's really something that we believe is very important as we think about what we're purchasing on behalf of our members.
Thank you, Marissa. Marcia, you want to talk about your work?
Sure. Can you hear me? Okay. I'm Marcia Peterson, and I'm with the Washington State Healthcare Authority, where I'm in charge of benefit design and strategy within the public employees area. The Healthcare Authority is a state agency within the state government. We purchase healthcare for about 2 million people in the state, which includes Apple Healthcare or Medicaid, and also the public employees, so that's everybody from all of the state agencies, including, say, Department of Corrections, Department of Health, State Fish and Wildlife, and the legislature, as well as higher ed, so University of Washington, basically all the higher ed, and then other state and local government as well. And soon, starting in January 1st of 2020, we will be purchasing healthcare for all of the school employees in the state. So that's a little thing that we're rolling out right now. So we're big. In terms of the role of, when I think of the role of the healthcare purchaser, we have kind of a somewhat unique role. It's not unique, but it's kind of an unusual role in that we are so big. And I think that one of the responsibilities that we have, or actually we do have a mandate to do value-based purchasing. One of the responsibilities that we have is, and one of the opportunities that we have actually, since we are so big, is that we can write the rules. I've worked for many years on the provider side and found so many providers who felt so constrained by the way that payers were paying them. You know, we pay folks in healthcare to do, 2 weeks in the ICU. Great, you get a great reimbursement for that. But we don't pay people to have a nurse call somebody up at home and say, are you taking your medicine, Mrs. Smith? Have you stepped on the scale? How do you feel? Keeping people out. So we have the opportunity to kind of rewrite the rules. And I think that's what we kind of have done, to work with providers through direct contracting, which is something that we've done in the last few years. We have a couple of areas that we've done direct contracting, where we've essentially worked with providers to rewrite the rules. And the first one Michael actually worked with us on is we offer a couple of accountable care program, a couple of accountable care networks here locally, actually within Washington State, to our members. And there's two networks. One is Puget Sound High Value Network, which is basically Virginia Mason and Evergreen. And then there's also the University of Washington Accountable Care Network. So the two of them, we rewrote the rules basically so that they're rewarded based on finances as well as quality. So the other area of direct contracting is our Center of Excellence program that we did around hip and knee replacement, where we contracted with a Center of Excellence, it's Virginia Mason, to offer our members center hip and knee replacement for a fixed fee. If our members use the Center of Excellence, they have no out-of-pocket cost. It follows the BREE criteria. We check on the outcomes. We basically say, here's the money, you guys figure it out, do the right thing, we'll be watching, and you need to follow quality criteria. And the results have been phenomenal. We've saved a lot of money for the taxpayers, and the patients are incredibly happy. They love the experience, and the clinical outcomes have been quite phenomenal. So I guess I'll end there.
Thanks. So my name is Michael Garrett. I'm a principal at Mercer. Mercer is a global human resources consulting company. We're part of Marsh McLennan family of companies, and Mercer has three lines of business. Wealth, which deals with retirement plans, career, which deals with workforce planning and organizational development, and health, which is the area that I work in. Within our health consulting practice, we are hopefully seen as trusted advisors to employers. We work with employers probably 100 or 200, all the way up to hundreds of thousands of employees across the country. And in our benefits consulting practice, we have generalists that work with our clients, usually the benefit managers and the chief human resources officer or CHRO or VP of HR, to work on benefits to hopefully attract and retain talent, which is particularly challenging these days. And working with employers, of course, they're very different depending on the industry, manufacturing versus high tech, and so forth, but they all have the desire to attract and retain talent. Now, having said that, in terms of innovation, you have, I will call them laggards in terms of innovation that kind of go kicking and screaming into innovation. You have the watchful waiters, like let somebody else test it out, see if it works, and then we'll adopt it, kind of midway through. And then you have the innovators who want to be at the cutting edge, and those frankly tend to be high tech companies that want every whiz bang new bright shiny object, or BSO that we call it, put that in our array of things that we can offer people to attract them. And particularly the millennials and the Gen Zs that are entering the workforce are looking at benefits, different kinds of benefits, so student loan payment, things around gender equity or coverage of transgender services. I do work around that, around diversity and inclusion, and how benefits are impacted by that D&I or diversity inclusive area. I think an overarching theme with employers is they want to have a healthy, productive workforce. So that can summarize really what employers are looking for from their health benefits and really from innovations. How is that helping achieve a healthy, productive workforce? And remembering too that when we talk about that, it's not just the medical plan, but it's the dental plan, it's the vision plan, it's the workers' compensation plan, it's long-term disability, and sometimes we lose sight of that because those could be in different areas with an employer. But an employer at a CFO or CEO or C-suite level is really looking at all of those programs. So just to remember that it's not just medical, we kind of get in our own little world and think that it's just medical. So Mercer has a Center for Healthcare Innovation, or CHI, that identifies and catalogs and evaluates different innovators. Spend a fair amount of my time with healthcare innovators and entrepreneurs. One of the challenges is they tend to be very siloed, very focused, for example, on the consumer and the member, and they forget that they live in a benefits ecosystem. There's other benefit programs out there. There's the health plan, and then there's a healthcare team. And so that would be my piece of advice to innovators, is to make sure that you understand that you operate in several different ecosystems that you have to proactively share and participate in.
So this is a good time to actually go on the poll everywhere and start asking any questions that you have. And I see a few of them. And the first one, you already talked about that you have worked with each other. But in a general sense, how collaborative is the healthcare industry here in Seattle and in Washington in general? So Marissa, you want to talk about your experience?
Sure. I mean, I think that the industry is pretty collaborative here in Washington. I think that part of what is exciting about being in Washington is often led by the healthcare authority as a really large purchaser. We are out in front. And so I think we see a lot of collaboration. We work really closely with our carrier partners. That being said, I think that there are some challenges with the traditional delivery system that we continue to encounter. And we're really looking for stuff that's outside of the traditional delivery system because we know that that's not going to solve all of the healthcare needs of our populations.
You want to take it?
Sure. I would say in this market, the healthcare providers are very collaborative with purchasers. I think there's a growing understanding that to achieve real care transformation, reduce costs, achieve quality, that we cannot live in silos and we cannot butt heads all the time. I was just thinking about when you were talking about being on the provider side. I mean, traditionally, purchasers and providers or plans would just, browbeat one another to come up with an acceptable fee schedule. But with the creation of things like centers of excellence, accountable care organizations, other value-based care arrangements, there needs to be a collaborative negotiation. And when I talk to colleagues in other parts of the country, they're not quite there yet. But I think there's great formats and forums, for example, Washington Health Alliance, the Foundation for Healthcare Quality, Cambia Grove, and other organizations that really provide lots of different ways that all these different stakeholders collaborate and communicate with one another and have the tools and information and resources, Bree Collaborative and another, to come together at the same table.
So there's a lot of collaboration, and I agree with everything that everyone's saying, but there's also, I think, a lot of tension and a long history of lack of trust, I would just say. May I just say that? I'm just like elephant in the room. Between providers and health plans and from purchasers as well. And I think so much of that comes from not getting together and collaborating and not talking directly about, that's what's so exciting about today is purchasers can talk directly with providers. We work closely with our health plans and say, this is really what our members need. This is what we're seeing. We work, Susie Dade standing in the back of the room, we work really closely, the Washington Health Alliance and the Purchasers Association. We work really closely together, a lot of us purchasers, to talk about a lot of these issues. So there's a lot of collaboration going on, but there's some tension there too.
Thank you. How about we move on to the industry trend and we can come back and loop to some of the questions that are coming. I know each of us have picked a topic to give a flavor. We're going to talk about the behavioral health benefits, the new consumerism, which is the Fitbit, and all the digital health and the app stuff that's going on, and the pay for value and drive for quality. So how about we start with Mike? You want to talk about the idea of new consumerism?
No, I'm doing pay for value. Yeah.
Go ahead. Go for pay for value. Yep.
Arm wrestled over that one.
That we did, yeah.
I won.
So I'm going to be relying on you a lot, Marcia. So so let me actually start by framing. There are three key ways that purchasers, plan sponsors, can control costs. So the first one is to pay up less for services. So that's the browbeating to get a lower unit price, centers of excellence, which are the bundled payment approach, or other value-based care alternative payment methodology. And CMS has come up with the alternative payment framework that shows a graduated move towards risk sharing with providers. So that's one way of doing it and has traditionally been done a lot by plans and purchasers. The second way is to limit what you pay for. So that can be done by exclusions and limitations in the plan booklet, It can be increased scrutiny with prior authorization, so you kind of batten down the hatches and when how you do utilization manager prior authorization so that you pay for fewer services. And those are kind of two key tools that purchasers have used historically. The last one is to have less need for services. And so that requires care transformation, new different kinds of care delivery models, new different kinds of payment methodologies, like accountable care organizations, clinically integrated networks. You know, we've gone from ACO to CINing, I say, so with CINs. So that takes time. So the National Business Group on Health, for example, in their ACO toolkit shows that it takes 3 to 7 years to achieve the care transformation necessary for a really risk-bearing, fully integrated, coordinated, information-sharing, ideal delivery system model that requires patience and a stair-stepped approach to how you drive to value-based payments and shift the risk to providers. The providers have to be ready for it. It's a tremendous change in how care is delivered, working in care teams, integrating with behavioral health, doing proactive population health management with care managers that ingest and digest, if you would, data from claims and health risk assessments and biomedical devices and all sorts of different kinds of things, evidence-based guidelines. So that just takes time. So ultimately, that's what we want to achieve, but there has to be bridge strategies to get there. And healthcare quality is another issue, and we have, again, Washington Health Alliance that puts out quality data on providers and other methods to show what quality is and what the member experience is. So I probably exceeded my 2 minutes.
Some of the questions that are coming around that is, how do you demand these values-based arrangements, and how receptive are your collaborators?
Say the first part again.
From the audience, can you point out who asked that question? The question is, how do you as purchasers demand these value-based arrangements, and how receptive are your collaborators?
I think, first of all, you don't demand it. I think you enter into a dialogue with between the purchaser and the plan, the purchaser plan and the provider, that is a dialogue. The second thing is you have to come up with reasonable expectations for the change. As I mentioned, it's not a flick the switch. ACOs are not an overnight. Anyone that works with them, and I'm just using ACO as an example, it could be clinically integrated network or patient-centered medical home or whatever flavor you want to talk about. It takes time. You have to set reasonable parameters. Information sharing and data integration is huge. Providers typically have not been used to receiving claims data, for example, and so now they're going to be getting claims data. How do we do sense making out of the data? So once you build the pipes, then what's the algorithm to make sense out of to know what to do with that information? How do you incorporate biomedical information, digital health app information in a sophisticated kind of way? So it takes time, and I think you just have to have the rules of the game set up that is cooperative and reasonable expectations, good communication.
Thank you, Mike. The next topic we are going to talk about is the new consumerism. Marcy, you want to start with that?
Sure. Well, this is a topic that we could just do an entire day on, but I have 2 minutes, so no problem. New consumerism is huge, but I'm just gonna focus on personal health technology real quickly here. Raise your hand if you're wearing a Fitbit, or wrong hand, Apple Watch, something like that, some personal health, okay, like everyone has these things. So it's interesting, as purchasers, we're aware of this, some of us are paying for them, I've seen in the market, you're probably seeing, there's tremendous possibility there. Interestingly enough, probably all of you know this, but these things that have started out kind of around supporting, you know, athleticism and, you know, making me do better things around behavioral health are extending now into chronic care and supporting, say, people with behavioral health issues. And there's some very, very exciting things that are around this. But there's also some things that just like you just scratch your head and you go, what? What is this really about? So there's a tremendous potential here. We're just not quite sure what to do with it yet. And like all technology, there's good and there's bad. It goes with it. There's like the happy part of it, and then there's the dark side. So I was just going to touch on a few things that I see, that we see from the purchaser's perspective, at least at the Healthcare Authority, as we've looked into this. And on the good side, of course, these tools can help us manage our own health. It breaks through the model of the idea that I have to go to the doctor and talk to the doctor, who is the keeper of all knowledge, by the way, about something that I could probably manage myself. And it can extend care to remote locations, which is fantastic, and we're seeing that has great potential for rural health care and very convenient as well. And there's some very cool things out there. I wish we could spend a whole day to talk about it, because in our community, there are some really great technologies out there. Bad? Is it evidence-based? Is any of this evidence-based? Is it making a difference? Is it improving care? And what's happening to all that data that we're sending somewhere, not sure where? And what happens when consumers, and this does happen, maybe some of you in the room are doing this, when the consumer insists on sending terabytes of data to their own physician with the idea that their physician is going to sit down and actually look at this data to help manage their care? Obviously, that's not going to happen. So like I said, like any technology or like any innovation, there's really positive aspects of it, and then there's also things that maybe are unintended consequences at all.
Very interesting. So on that aspect, what Mike talked about, the bright, shiny objects, which one you have seen that has succeeded? I would say Apple Watch is one of them that has seen some success, and which you think should have succeeded but haven't? Anything that you've seen around type 1 diabetes or the glucose monitoring? Telehealth, for example, is a great one.
Maybe somebody else in the audience knows more, but we've tried to look to see if is it evidence-based? Are there real outcomes? And really, there haven't been studies that we've seen yet, which is not to say that there aren't real outcomes. It's just that it hasn't been studied yet. There's so many apps. I mean, go out and look. There's thousands and thousands of apps.
Interestingly, we've rolled out a couple of different kind of online app-based programs. And one of the keys to some of their success has been when somebody has actually been able to engage personally. So although they might be online and kind of self-service, we have been piloting an online diabetes prevention app, and really the key to that success is the ability to engage with other people, so to have a community of support. And I think that that's one of the challenges with a lot of these different kind of new technologies, is that actually people being able to download them and use them, and how do they integrate, and then if you're just using it on your own, where's the either accountability, or where do you go with questions or challenges? And so that's what we've really found is it's not necessarily the technology on its own, but the what you build around it that really is one of the keys to success.
You're talking about Omada, the Omada program?
No, it's a different program.
It's a different
program. But it's similar too, yeah.
So we have rolled that out as mm-hmm. well, which is a digital program with coaching. You use your phone, they send you a wireless scale, and it's for, yeah. And in terms of participation, compared with the on-site, you know, go to a site to take classes, no comparison. Mm-hmm. The participation is so much higher. Has it really working? We don't know yet.
I think also the issue too is not just looking at enrollment, but sustained engagement. That's the key. So that you can get people like, oh, they downloaded the app. Well, that's not engagement. Mm-hmm. It's like, are they still using it 6 months out? And I think what this points to is that behavior change, whether it's an individual person or an organization, is hard. It's hard to achieve it, and it's hard to sustain it. Mm-hmm. And to your question that you asked about what should work, what I was hoping what would really work is digital navigation, digital navigators. There are several apps out there that really bring in all of them together in theory, and they just aren't there yet. And I think the technology isn't quite there yet to bring all the digital apps. The other concern that I have about digital apps is that this deals with diabetes, but they don't deal with your cardiovascular, and they don't deal with your depression, and they don't deal, and then there's lack of integration and information sharing and coordination. So it ends up, we deal with a siloed part of me, and come to find out I'm a whole person. I'm not just my diabetes, I'm not just my depression, I'm not just my heart condition, I'm all of that. And that's another concern I have about digital apps, is they're not really addressing the whole, or they don't know what to do. They may not even be screening for it, and then if they do screen for it, where do they go with it? Where do they make a referral, or how do they make sure someone gets connected?
Yeah, good point. So that's more on the patient side, but how about the healthcare provider side for you and your organizations? Are there innovations that you're seeing that is helping your organization do a better job?
Well, the one that we just talked about, the online diabetes prevention programs, we're using that. We also use another one that is a wellness program. It's a digital wellness program. Many of you are probably familiar with these approaches. This one is by Limeade. It's a local company that's actually national, and it's a way to incentivize our members. If they participate in this and participate in activities, it counts up the points, and then at the end of the year, you know, they get a certain percentage off of their deductible next year. Classic sort of wellness program, but it's a very clever, uses gamification, uses a lot of technology, and is pretty popular. So we're getting good results from that, we feel.
So if your question is what have providers done around innovation, health innovation, is that what you're asking?
More on not only just making the patient's life better, but also the provider's life better.
So one example that comes to mind when you ask that question is I would call it kind of behind the scenes or back end service that actually helps connect primary care physicians to behavioral health specialists. So we know that high percentage of primary care visits are behavioral health in nature. I don't mean to steal your thunder because you're going to talk about behavioral health. And when you talk to primary care physicians, they're like, well, we don't know where to refer people. We don't know the network. We don't know if someone is accepting patients. What's the difference between a clinical social worker and a marriage and family therapist, and which one should they go to? And the delivery system is different in behavioral health. There's no correlation on the physical health side, so residential treatment, intensive outpatient, and so forth. And so this service actually helps connect primary care to behavioral health and then facilitates communication back and forth. It's more between providers. It's a little bit member-facing, but mostly, and it's been very successful. It's been rolled out in this area. So that's an example of, even though the member may not be aware of it or the patient may not be aware of it, and it's still kind of new, but so I have hope for that.
So this is a good segue to jump to the behavioral health benefits. Marissa, you want to talk about that?
Sure. So one of the trends that we're really seeing and that's really important to us as a purchaser is around behavioral health. And we've been thinking a lot about this. I think that in the industry and just in general, there's a recognition that there's a lot of unmet behavioral health needs in many different populations, and that it's not necessarily a one-size-fits-all solution. There's obviously a lot of stigma around behavioral health needs, and then we all know that there's some pretty significant challenges in terms of providers and provider networks and provider shortages and wait times to get in to see people. And so we really looked at this, and we did some research around our population. Again, we serve caregivers. Many of our caregivers, about 25% actually speak a language other than English. So there's just a lot of barriers and a lot of stigma. So when we did some research, we found that there was a huge unmet need, yet we had less than 1% utilization of our behavioral health benefit, even when we took away all of the what we thought were the barriers in terms of copays, so people could access behavioral health services without any out-of-pocket cost. And we really didn't see an increase in utilization at all. So we said we need to think about this differently. And what we really did is looked at meeting people where they were at and providing many different kinds of benefits, kind of looking outside of a clinical benefit. So we have engaged with a text-based coaching app, which kind of segues from our last conversation, and have started to have some really good success. This is a company called Ginger. And so people can download the app, which actually there's been more barriers around downloading the app than anything else. But people engage and they have access to a coach within about a minute and can then text 24/7. And it kind of gets at, it's really this life coaching model, so it gets at, they can help you with stress, they can help you with work problems, they can help you with family, whatever it is, there's not really a limit. And then there's a lot of self-help tools as well that they can refer people to. And if people need an extra level of clinical care, then they get referred to clinical providers who they can engage with through the app to do telebehavioral health services. So that's something that we've really piloted. And the other thing that we have been looking at is actually mindfulness. And so we have engaged and started a mindfulness program. And I will own that I was not convinced in the beginning about it, but we have seen really solid clinical results. And even 3 months out, after people finish the program, pretty significant decreases in depression and anxiety. And so we're trying to really look at this as, you know, many people have a need that's at a clinical level that they need specialty behavioral health services, but many people don't. And there's so many barriers to actually getting in that we're trying to kind of piece together things that maybe will be helping people where they're at.
So Marsha, for 2 million purchases, an impact for something like this would be huge. So what kind of impact you are seeing in behavioral health, all the work that your team is doing?
What is the impact that we're seeing on behavioral health? Well, one of the things that we've tried to pilot with the Accountable Care Program is to foster, again, it's that take away the constraints and allow the providers to do what they are best at doing, which is innovating in some ways. And we've seen some really remarkable work done around integrating primary care with mm-hmm. behavioral health, which is a really important aspect of that. So that's very exciting. I am really interested in following up on and looking more into for following benefit years around Ginger, and also on how we can encourage the use of telehealth for behavioral health, which I think we've just barely, I don't even think our members are probably even aware that that's a possibility. So looking more into that is something that we want to do for following years as well.
I think that solution, there's other solutions out there. I mean, I'm familiar with Ginger. Vita is another solution that does similar kinds of things. It addresses several issues. One is, no one sees you drive to an office that says psychotherapy associates or whatever, right? So there's an anonymity to it. It's on demand, so it addresses the consumer issue. The only thing that is a little unsettling for me is being really crisp about what do coaches handle and what do licensed therapists handle, and making sure that connection's really tight, because the patients can go back and forth between coaches and licensed therapists. And when they talk to me about it, I think they're really clear about that. But there are more behavioral health providers that will sign up for that kind of program, because organizations like Ginger or Vita, they take care of all the billing for the behavioral health providers. Mm-hmm. So that's a very attractive thing for them. So they don't have to deal with all that administrative hassle, because the issue is so many behavioral health providers are not in any network. But if I can sign up for that network, I can do it when I want to. I don't have to have an office. There's a lot of things attractive to behavioral health providers. The other thing I will say about behavioral health that makes my actuarial colleagues at Mercer really nervous is that you don't want a behavioral health cost to be too low. Because if behavioral costs are low, it's popping up in other areas. And that can mean ER visits, medications, time loss from work, lots of different issues. And so when we're looking at report outs that carriers and administrators do on an annual basis, my eye goes to not overutilization, but underutilization of behavioral health services, or what are the types of behavioral health services. So if it's 3% of the spend, and most of it's on inpatient psychiatric admissions, like, we're doing a bad job of providing outpatient care and preventing those admissions. That's not the optimal way to provide behavioral health care. There's instances like that. So I would just suggest that purchasers need to look at it from a different lens and not just reducing costs and utilization, but actually increasing it in order to achieve better outcomes for the whole person.
Yeah, and that was actually what prompted us to start to look at it as well, is that we had a pretty high avoidable ER spend, and we looked at it and had a pretty high percentage of generalized anxiety disorder. And that was really the diagnosis of some of those avoidable ER visits. And so I think that's right on, is that it is gonna manifest in different ways. The other thing I think that we found, the precursor to kind of looking at Ginger actually, was we ran a behavioral health navigation pilot to really understand what are the barriers, why can't people get in. And the experience is, as probably you know, many of you know, you call and you get a list of X number of people, and then you have to call them, and many of them are, you know, the private practice, and so then you get a call back, or you don't, and you don't know if they have time, and it's just hard, and people just give up. And so we just really looked at, you know, that we have to figure out a different way to try and get people in, and also maybe not everyone needs that level of care.
So most of this work is being adapted from outside, or your organizations are driving these changes and asking your teams to develop them, or asking to go out and find these solutions and your teams are funding them?
I was just going to say, I think in the last 5 years, what's happened is benefit managers are being bombarded with digital apps, point solutions, as they're called. So I don't think anyone has to go out to find them. They're knocking on the doors of all the benefit managers.
My email inbox is quite full.
In person, at conferences, and so there's been a plethora of point solutions. So if you go to market, I mean, there's just a lot of them. Our organization has this clamshell of all these different, by category, of all these different innovative solutions out there, and there's lots of them. So it's really sorting through who they and what they are, and also being really clear about what are you looking for. Like, for example, you're doing coaching and then treatment, but now you're going to prevention with mindfulness, you know. So you have to look at the spectrum, and some of these solutions, you have to be really clear what it is that they do, which part of that continuum, is it preventing, is it identifying and screening, or is it treating, or all the way, and then what modality, because some do text-based, there's a company here in town, 98.6, that does text-based primary care. There's companies that do text-based therapy. Ginger doesn't do that, but some do text-based therapy, psychotherapy. So you have to think about your population, what makes sense, what are you comfortable with. They're not all the same. Yeah.
The other thing that I would say that we look for in vendors, and what we've been really successful, or the vendors that have worked with us have been successful, are a lot of you know, vendors who are in a startup mode who are really flexible. We really like to look at something on a really small scale and figure out how it works or if it doesn't work. And if it doesn't work, then, you know, we're not going to pursue it, versus trying to roll something out to all 20,000 people off the bat and then figuring out it doesn't work. And so sometimes that actually is easier with a startup, because you know, there aren't as many processes or operations pieces in place. Sometimes that's not very easy either.
We're large, we're a public agency, and our one of our constraints is competitive procurement laws. So it can be very frustrating to not be able to just, you know, meet someone at a conference and say, hey, you know, come on over, or, you know, we'll chat, we'll work something out. It's like, no, I need to understand everything that you do, and now I will write that into a competitive procurement and send that out, and 25 people will respond, and half of them don't even know what it is. So that is just one of the challenges that I find in working in this area and innovation.
And I would say that that's true in some of the private sector. So that's a philosophical decision. Well, it's a regulatory, but it's a philosophical decision as a purchaser. Do you want to go out and have 18 contracts with 18 different digital apps, or do you have your administrator or carrier hold the umbrella contract? Or there are actually organizations out there that will do that. For Solera is an example that they have a catalog of vendors that they've all contracted with, so you only hold a contract with Solera, mm-hmm. and then they have this array of vendors that are non-clinical in nature that you can select from. And so then that helps with the procurement. But the private sector has that as well, particularly the larger ones. They have a very onerous procurement. And so on the flip side, do you want to put all your eggs in one basket with one organization that holds all those contracts? So it's a philosophical decision, too, about how
you
approach it.
That's why we tend to work with our carriers, so Regents, you know, our TPA. We work with them, and usually they are the ones who turn around and contract with these providers after we've done some research sometimes.
I see. So on the ROI side, how are you measuring the return on investment on these kind of apps? Are you actively measuring that and giving feedback to the provider and see how it can be improved? Because you have a large user base that is going out and using them and telling you what is right and what is not right.
We want to. I would say we're trying to. I think that we have a couple of things that are going to be put into place to try and measure impact and loop back into our claims data. Mm-hmm. Those are not quick things, and then you have all the complexity of the data shares and how does that work. But that is really our goal, is to look at the ROI, or at least, and I think the ROI is challenging when you try and link it to the claims or the cost. But we have been able to look at some particular clinical indicators and really measure those. So we might not be able to say it's saving us X amount, but we can say it is decreasing depression and anxiety by X amount.
Your experience, Marcia?
Well, that's one of the hard things about preventing something from happening. How do you measure that? And we've run into this with our wellness program where there was quite a lot of question about what is the ROI, and everyone knows this here in this room, there's a lot of question about what is the ROI of wellness programs. And I always want to say, what is the ROI of heart surgery? I mean, really, do we offer that benefit, and no one says, what's the ROI on that? So I know maybe I'm probably passing the buck on that, but it is very challenging to measure something that is preventing something from happening 20 years down the road when it's population-based.
And I would say that I think you have to begin with what are you trying to achieve with the solution that informs you about what metrics you're going to use to make sure that it was successful. So with the behavioral health thing, it could be initially maybe it's engagement and sustained, you know, enrollment and sustained engagement. That might be the first. So I think start with what are we trying to solve here, and then that will lead you, I think, to the metrics. And I always use the three buckets of metrics, so clinical metrics, member experience metrics, and financial metrics. And we work with different employers, and so for some, for example, the financial is the most important. Others are member experience, because they're driving towards attracting, retaining talent. So their member experience is the most important thing. And of course, clinical quality would also be important. So those are kind of the three domains, but I think each employer is gonna have something different, and it's going to evolve over time, particularly with, you know, digital apps and innovative kinds of solutions.
So one question that popped up for you, Michael, how large does an employer need to be to start these value-based contracting dialogues? And I think that pops up for everyone. Where do you start?
Well, all of the major carriers offer value-based care contracts, mm-hmm. from fully insured to self-funded. There's probably three different ways that you can do value-based contracts. Most employers are going to accept the value-based contract that the carriers offer, kind of as is. The second would be a customized ACO to meet the needs, but still through the plan, which is essentially what Microsoft did with their Health Connect product. Premier holds the contract, but Microsoft provided lots of input about how to customize it for them. And the third would be the direct contract, which is the healthcare authority has done that, and the Boeing company has done that, and other companies like Disney has done that. So So those are the three methods to do it. The smaller you are, the more likely you're going to accept the package deal, if you would, from the carrier. If you're much larger, you can do customize it to meet your needs, and then you have to be really jumbo with a lot of people in an area, like the healthcare authority or the Boeing company, to do a direct provider contract. And those will be far and few between.
Thank you. And the other question that popped up was around PCBBH connection service. What is that called? There were a couple of questions who asked.
Primary care patient-centered home, is that what you mean? Oh, behavioral health integration. What was the question? Oh, Quartet Health. Sorry.
I'm not sure who answered.
Quartet Health is the solution. I want to be careful about promoting any solution, but Quartet Health and Premier uses them. I think Evergreen Health, as a health system, has contracted with them. That's a solution. It's the only one that I'm aware of that does that particular function. Very popular with primary care physicians. I mean, it's like they're really relieved to know a resource to go to help them with this area. Very preliminary, but so far results seem to be positive.
Okay. So I'm surprised nobody asked questions about the new player in this field, which is the Microsoft, the Amazon, JP Morgan collaboration. Heaven.
What are they doing? Does anyone know what they're doing? I mean, lots of talk. Where is the product? I don't know.
So that's a good question to ask. What would you expect if they're not talking? What do you think they will come up with? You're expecting that it's going to be a standard copy of what's already in the system? Or you think they being tech firms and always on the leading edge of innovation, they will come up with something really exciting? What's your perspective? Any opinions?
I think they're going to try and figure out how people can purchase healthcare like they purchase stuff on Amazon. That's what I think, but I think it's going to be obviously very challenging. Right.
Drones. I think a couple of thoughts. One is I think it's whatever they do is going to be a consumer-facing solution,
yeah,
to your point. I think they could leverage technology to have a highly functional data intermediary that collects claims, biomedical, digital health, patient-reported outcomes. That could be another thing that they do. And some kind of, you know, the whole hospital at home movement where you have all the bioindicators at home that feed information to a health system to maybe help jumpstart that kind of thing. So I think it's going to be something around technology, particularly into consumer. I doubt that it's going to be something for providers. I don't think it's going to be something for purchasers or plans. I just think they're going to aim at members. But that, I come back in 2 years, I'm probably wrong. I don't know.
I don't know what it will be either, but I suspect it'll have something to do with AI, and they have tremendous amounts of data and gathering data and looking at it and coming up with ways to predict disease or treatment activities or create products around those things. I honestly don't know, but that would be my suspicion. That's where they can leverage their experience.
I see.
My experience in working with, say, Microsoft in the past in this area is that if you're from Microsoft here, but they really don't understand healthcare. And they think, how hard can it be, right? I mean, we're big, we're Microsoft, and it's like everyone here knows how hard it can be. It is not a rational system. It doesn't behave like other systems do. The consumer has a completely different role than in other, say, retail, et cetera. The information isn't available. So maybe in that area of information, maybe they can crack the code of making information available to people to make better choices.
So you think they are in a position to shake up the purchaser market just by their sheer size or the ideas around what they can bring? Because when you combine the three companies, it's a large number of of purchases in terms of the employees, but it's not really that significant. So they probably can make some impact by volume, but probably not so much. The impact where they can make is bringing the new innovation, new ideas like AI or into the EHR system, for example. So those will be something to watch out for. But the fact that it's been more than a year and nobody has heard anything, and some people have started leaving already, so I'm not quite sure which will go.
Seen that pattern before.
Yeah, I think that combination understands technology really well, and they understand consumers really well. And what they don't understand is care delivery, and what they don't understand is insurance or claims administration. They could learn it, but do they have a line of sight to that? So that's why I think something's going to be around technology and consumer orientation, not in the care delivery necessarily, except where technology can supplant, and I don't think also insurance. I don't know.
I see. So let me come back to the behavioral aspect we just talked about. One question is around trauma-informed care. How are you approaching in your organizations the trauma-informed care?
So we are working on that right now, actually. We did a study recently where we did an ACEs survey, so the Adverse Childhood Experiences survey, for our specific population. And we actually found that in our population, there was a really high incidence of people who had four or more ACEs, which is some pretty significant trauma. And so we're taking that work, and we are looking at how we can really support people in accessing trauma-informed care. We also have, not only are we a benefits group, so we have a training fund and a retirement fund as well. So we're looking at our training fund and the way they offer training, and how can we make sure that it is from that lens, knowing our population, and then looking again at caregiver experiences as they experience the healthcare system, and trying to think about how we can provide experiences that don't re-traumatize people, and then also that can support them through the healthcare system.
Any experience in your team?
I think the challenge with trauma-informed care around ACEs particularly is you don't want the individual to have to repeat it 10 times that they were raped or they saw their parent murdered. We have to figure out somehow that the individual does not have to continue to repeat their story around what their ACEs are. And then the comfort level that providers have or whoever's interacting about how to deal with someone that is experiencing that, because we know people with ACEs have higher correlation with chronic disease, higher correlation with behavioral health, higher correlation with overall health service utilization and costs. So we need to do something about it, but how do we identify it and not have them having to repeat their story over and over again? I think the other issue that's sort of related to that is the whole social determinants of health area, which is a bit different than behavioral health, of understanding how someone lives, you know, housing, transportation, food, interpersonal violence, all those kinds of things, and how that impacts health. Some healthcare systems are starting to address that in a more systematic way, and the Z codes are coming in so the providers can collect information around that, and we can start looking at that. And some health plans are starting to do that. They purchase data so that their customer service reps and their clinicians can understand where someone lives and realize it's going to be difficult to get to a primary care physician that's accepting new patients. So how do they make that happen? And do they, you know, do an Uber or somehow to get them to there? Or how do they get healthy foods to them and help train people on how to cook with their healthy foods? So I think we're just beginning to see the uptake on that. So a little bit away, trauma-informed care, but I thought I'd mention that. And I don't know if you all are doing anything about social determinants of health.
We are also thinking a lot about that. We're kicking off a study to understand the impact in our population so that we can figure out what interventions we might be able to put into place.
Some of the challenges that we've run into around social determinants of health is It just has to do with the data.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have the data. I mean, we're talking about the forms that you fill out when you come to work, you know, at the Department of Health or wherever it is, and they just don't gather the kind of data that would help us even look at it. And I just want to put this, I mean, since this is a forum about purchasers as well, I think one of the challenges that we face as purchasers is how much do we get into this? I mean, as you mentioned, we're not the employer, right? Healthcare Authority is not the employer, and yet we sort of are the employer. We're purchasing healthcare for these agencies, for employers. There's this line that must be drawn, that must always be, this wall that must be between us as the sort of health plan, where we have access to some of this data, and us as employers. And people are, rightly so, very kind of reticent to share some of that information with their employer. How much do you really want your employer to know about, you know, the trauma that you had as a child, et cetera? So it's just something that, you know, we talk about a lot, we worry about a lot. We're very, very careful. I mean, we have like 3 privacy officers within the Healthcare Authority who we go to constantly to say, can we look at this data? Is this even appropriate for us to look at this kind of data? Which limits us in some ways. And so that's where we turn to our partners on the plan side, on the provider side, and say, you know, this is really up to you to figure out. We think it's a problem. What are you gonna give us for our members to help them with? But we have to have that line drawn between us and the data.
I think that's really important, particularly around ACEs. On the other hand, social determinants of health, there's public health data that plans or providers could purchase and have, and to look at zip code as opposed to individual people. And, you know, as they say, zip code is a better predictor of health costs than your genetic code. And because it, you know, just going from one zip code to another, life expectancy can go down and more chronic conditions and so forth. So even at the zip code level, just knowing where someone lives, how that impacts their ability to go to the doctor or get healthy food or how they live. You roll out something about mindfulness and I'm hearing bullets fly by at night. It's not gonna work. It's not the mindfulness app, it's where they live. It's just, that's not, you know, it's gonna be challenging. I'm not saying you shouldn't do it, but we have to remember where people live every day as well.
So we have about 20 more minutes. We'll come back to the panel to ask some of the questions that we have in here. But I want to open up to the audience. Any questions that you want to ask besides what's on the poll everywhere? Go ahead.
I want to ask the panel about the social determinants data. Right? What would be the best data, if you can get any data you want, what would be looking for? What kind of data are you looking for?
Well, the Department of Health may have data. There's federal, like the BRFIS data, the Behavioral Risk Factor Surveillance System data. So there's federal agencies that do surveys. There's the state of Washington that does surveys, and they collect that data. It is not individual specific. It's public health and zip code indicated. But you can purchase those data sets as a way to get at that. Is that what you mean? Is the word, like, where does the data live?
I think he's talking about what's the actual data. So. Age, I mean, basic demographics, age, race, income, education.
Housing.
Right.
Bus lines.
Food insecurity.
Yeah.
Immigrant status.
Crime.
There's a question on the back.
So you guys are all benefits people. I wanted to give you a hypothetical problem and I'm an employer, I have 1,000 people, let's make it easier, it's public, so it's a public employee. And I say to you, I want to be able to increase services, reduce out-of-pocket payment for my employees, I want you to reduce costs by 10% total, and I want you to improve clinical outcomes. How would you do it?
For 1,000 people?
Yeah. Or do you think you can't do it?
Join a purchasers coalition because you're not big enough. With 1,000 people, it's going to be really difficult to affect change. And I don't mean to be flip. I mean, it's really hard with 1,000 people as opposed to 350,000
people. I'll give you 5,000.
Okay, you're six. So I think what you're asking is, what are the most valuable?
Yeah, well, I
things
guess I'm
to do.
I hear a lot of points to the point, you know, just like digital point solutions. I hear us all. I've spent my life working with employers for 40 years now, and I listen to lots of little things being done. I haven't heard anybody do the moonshot approach, saying, let's literally change this sucker instead of saying, let's go from.
Are we talking about single payer? Is that what you?
No, I'm not. No, I don't think that's it either. I'm just saying, I can see where we get happy when we go, well, it wasn't an 8% increase; it was only a 4.5% increase this year. And we go, yay! And it's like, you know, you're already paying too much. Employers are being driven out of the space, so settling for that. So, if you were going to solve for the real big picture, what would you solve? What would you try?
It's all the things we're trying. It isn't. I don't think there's one silver bullet. It's a lot of little things that mount up. I mean, the healthcare system is huge and vast, and if you squeeze it on one end, it bulges out on the other. So you try all of these things. I honestly, within the healthcare authority, you know, we have a lot of people who are very excited about the innovations, and they, you know, feel passionately about it. I do too. And sometimes we get ourselves all, you know, in, you know, get our 90 in a knot about it. You know, mine's the best, yours is the best, this is never gonna work. And sometimes I just stop and go, you know, 10 years from now, we're going to look back and go, that was really cute that we tried that, right? Like, that didn't work. But some other things did. So I just think it's really important that we try all of these things and that we look at them and we look at the outcomes and that we share them with other purchasers and we say, you know what, this worked. And here are the lessons learned that you should use. Small employers, that is a real problem, to not be able to buy into a larger purchasing collaborative, and that's what I would recommend to them as well.
And I think Marcia's right. There's not like a magic bullet, but my advice would be is to get really engaged, because I think we were in a situation where we had double-digit increases, and that was about 8 years ago, and we now have a negative trend. And so I think part of it, it's all of these things working together and understanding your population and engaging with the partners that are actually going to help you get there. You know, so it's value-based benefit design, and it's looking at payment structures, and it's looking at communications, and it's looking at engagement. I don't think it's one magic thing that's gonna happen overnight.
I also would say, look at your data. And look at what is the strategic plan of your organization so that you align your benefits with your strategy. Like, is your company planning on purchasing three other companies in four locations around the country? That would be a different strategy than we're staying in Everett, Washington, and we're gonna grow 2% a year. That just has a huge impact on what I would recommend. If it's a manufacturing employee population, if the average age is 55 versus 30, all those things, I have to start with the data to find out, and then the strategic business plan of the organization. I think sometimes in HR and benefits, I'll blame myself, that we lose that side of what's the business, and what has gone well, what have they learned in the past from the benefit design, and you know, is it attracting, retaining talent, is it this aging workforce, all those kinds of questions, and then look at how's the benefit design going to optimize value from the providers, whether it's and value-based insurance design, so how can we affect member behavior? And then partnering with a really best-in-class administrator, assuming with 5,000 people you're self-funded, I hope, that has the vision that matches what your needs are the best.
Hi, I work for an insurance company and have an idea for a new insurance product, and the feedback that I've gotten so far is that HR managers are so scared of change that they're never going to say yes to this. And so I'm just wondering, like, what do you fear most when you change something or offer a new benefit for your employees? Like, what kind of questions do you get that you're like, wow, I don't even want to go there with some innovative new thing?
We like change. but we might be unique in that. I do think the biggest challenge is, I don't think that you can lob something over the wall and expect people to just automatically, you know, take advantage of it. And so I think it's really understanding what's the value, how do you communicate it, and how do you get in the engagement, because it could be the best product in the world, but if nobody does it, it's not of value. So I think that's the biggest challenge to trying something new.
I guess, you know, I would echo that, but a value, and a value to whom? And it would depend on the employer as well, the purchaser, and what their goals are. Within the healthcare authority, for instance, when we do innovation in our public employees benefits area, I'll tell you what we lead with, and we lead with quality. When we did the Centers of Excellence program, we called it a Centers of Excellence program. We never talked with our board. Our board had to vote on it. It's a board of 9 folks who were appointed by the governor, and they oversee the benefits, and they actually have authority over the benefits. And we really never talked about cost. A lot of people go into bundled payment programs and just, you know, clearly it's about the cost, and we always talked about the quality. We always focused on that. We believed that the cost savings would follow. So really, you need to understand the context of the employer, as you were saying, of the purchaser who's buying it, and what are they trying to do. Some of the challenges that they face that I hear from a lot of employers about doing any of these things, any of these value-based purchasing approaches, is they're afraid to bring change to their employees, because their employees basically are pretty cynical and think that any change to the benefits are going to be a takeaway. So, and with especially in Seattle, or in a lot of parts of Washington, the employment market is so difficult right now, is so challenging from the employer's perspective, particularly in tech. They're just going to go down the road. So they're really afraid to offer anything that looks kind of weird to folks. And a lot of this stuff's really hard to explain. What is the value? I mean, trying to explain the value of an accountable care program. We did focus groups with folks because we were trying to figure out, like, what should we call this? And it was fascinating because we had these focus groups, and we said, you know, so we're going to roll out these accountable care programs. And they're like, who are you holding accountable? What does that mean? You know, I was like,
yeah,
like,
that's really good. Yeah.
You know, is it me? Is it my doctor? Is my doctor going to get in trouble? I mean, all kinds of things. So trying to explain some of these things to consumers can be very challenging in terms of what's in it for them.
Words matter. I mean, Microsoft calls theirs Health Connect. Boeing calls theirs Preferred Partnership. That communicates something than Accountable Care Organization. I mean, that's our own lingo. I would say the flip side of that, to benefit managers, and I'm probably going to make my coworkers nervous, is inertia. And if you don't do anything, you're going to continue to get 6% a year increases. You're going to have people abandon your company because they can't get a good medical plan. So inertia has consequences. Doing something has consequences. So let's just be really clear up front. Doing nothing because everyone's busy and resource constrained has consequences. Doing something innovative also has consequences, but having a really clear vision about what are we trying to accomplish, what are the goals, building that into whatever solution you're creating or program. Nothing's a product anymore, they're all solutions, right? To make sure those metrics are there, I think implementation is really key to make sure that it gets launched correctly, but then knowing, have we achieved success? How will we know we've achieved success? So the benefit manager also has to translate this to the C-suite people to show what the connection is to the business strategy as well. So that will do it. And it's a lot of work, and the benefits people are stretched and they don't want more work. And so then our job a lot of times as consultants is to figure out how can we push some of that to the carrier or the solution to have them do a lot of the work, frankly, to make it happen. But my concern is inertia, just not doing anything, and costs escalate. You have people not staying, or you can't attract people because it's a crappy medical plan. And then someone's going to be breathing down their neck.
So we have about 10 more minutes. So let's talk about the high priority needs that need the solution right now. So First, we'll ask the panelists one high priority need they think of, and I'll open up to you and to ask, what do you think is the high priority need? So who wants to take a shot?
I can go first. I think one of the biggest challenges is around navigation and how do people easily access high-value care, and it is so complicated with so many different carriers. I think that Marcia's point about the value to employees is really important, because we can roll out all of these different solutions, but helping people understand how to actually access them, what the benefit to them is, and then just making it easy, because people are really busy. And so it's really, if I had a magic wand, I would want somebody to figure out how we can bring that all together and make it really easy for people to access a lot of the high quality services that might be out there.
So if you're looking for an idea to start a business, you want to start right here. Marcia?
Okay, I would like you to raise your hand if you've had a fabulous experience going onto your health plan site and finding a provider in the provider directory. That was really easy and fabulous, wasn't it? It was so much fun. Why is it that way? Every single plan has to have their own provider directory. It's a pain to navigate. They're all different. They don't work very well. They're inaccurate. They're terrifically inaccurate. It's very hard for the plans, and it's really hard for the providers, because they're doing these, you know, having to send databases all the time and try to harangue the doctors to upgrade their profiles all the time. They're just terrible. I don't understand why we can't have a single provider directory. I would love to see that. They're not
all Kaiser's provider directory. Yeah.
I'm talking about 100% of the providers in the state. I want to see them all in there. I want to see information about what plans they're in. I want to see if they're taking new members. I want, basically, as a member, as a user, I want to see if my plan, if I can access them through my plan. I want to see what they offer. I might want to see what kind of languages they speak. I might want to know if they ski. Maybe something about their philosophy. There's all kinds of things. Behavioral health is a huge issue. It's already come up here. Are they taking, particularly around behavioral health? It's just incredibly siloed and horribly inaccurate and so inefficient, and that bothers me.
So I'm going to make a suggestion that actually the Amazon Berkshire Hathaway might address, which is I think we need to have a better data repository that ingests data that's claims, EHR, biomedical, wearable, patient-reported outcomes, all these different disparate sources of data, and not only fixes the pipes so that gets someplace, but then there's sense-making out of it, so that there's informed algorithms to then say, with all this different data, then what does that mean to the consumer? What does that mean to the provider? And so there could be, you know, one data repository, but sense-making. So that's what I would say, is that we need to build that kind of approach. And I think in 5 or 10 years from now, we're going to look back and go, do you remember when we developed quality metrics just on claims? Remember, claims were never built for quality. Claims were meant to pay bills, not to report on quality. And we've only been relying on claims data for quality, and now we have all the different kinds of data, but we can't make sense of it yet. I think we're mired in the data, and we don't know what it means. And so having the algorithms and the artificial intelligence or machine learning or whatever, and blockchain to make sure we have the right patient identified, will be important. So that's my idea.
So one thing I liked about today's panel is that we are all purchasers, not just this panel. So what one thing you would like to have as a need sold, something that should be sold right away, anything that you could think of, we have about 5 minutes. Anything you would like to see, you can go as wild as AI solving all the healthcare problems to just reducing my next year's premium. Anything.
So I practiced medicine for 20 years, and what's going to bankrupt more patients is cancer therapy. With the rise of immunotherapy and cancer treatment costing $1 million for immunotherapy, that's going to bankrupt the country and the patients. We can't afford that. And I think it's going to lead directly to healthcare rationing, or the pharmaceutical industry is going to be required by the government to lower cost. And I think there's going to be an explosion over that.
Yeah, personally, I have an opinion about that. And immunotherapy is at a stage where the Human Genome Project was. The first person who was sequenced cost hundreds of millions of dollars, and today is a few hundred dollars. So I think at today's price, yes, but as the technology develops, I think the price will come down.
As pharmaceutical companies are more and more going into the rare disease discovery area, and we've now got a therapy to prevent a genetic form of blindness. It costs $1 million per eye. So it gets to the question of, how much is your sight worth? And if you can't afford that, is the government going to pick that up? Is Medicare or Medicaid going to pick that up? I mean, we've had this problem with the treatment for hepatitis C.
Mm-hmm. $82,000.
I was at an Oregon Health Department meeting 2 years back, And the Department of Health in Oregon said flat out that they cannot afford to put the Gilead treatment for hepatitis C,
yep,
on their formulary. They just couldn't do it.
So those of you are not aware, there has never been a medicine to completely eradicate Hep C. And today, you take 82 pills for 82 days. Each one costs $1,000. That's what you're talking about?
There's also the issue of what it costs to manufacture versus what the price is. And that could be two really different things. So the manufacturing costs can come down, the price still stays high.
Yeah.
Yep. If you cut us off, we're not going to argue.
Right. Yep. I don't have an answer for you. You're a really good point, and I think that we're going to have to face at some point in time rationing. And in some ways, we're already doing it, but we're just not explicit about it.
So we have a couple of more minutes. Any other questions?
I would say cost transparency to us as individual consumers. I mean, we go to the hospital, we have no clue as to what certain services, certain charges are going to end up being. And if you do that in the course of an emergency, you're just screwed.
Well, I was hoping the policy panel should have answered that question last time.
Yeah. Well, so there are transparency tools out there, quality and cost transparency tools. Very, very low engagement and utilization,
right,
exist. There's limited information about quality. A lot of the quality indicators are Medicare only, not relevant to a commercially insured population. So there's challenges there. I think the concept's a great one, but getting consumers to use that systematically is a challenge.
Yeah,
and
you can't do it instantaneously when you need it.
Right.
And you've got basically local monopolies if you're in an ambulance and going to the nearest place.
Right.
So.
And then there's the issue like I had years ago where I went to a hospital that was in network, but oh, by the way, the emergency physicians are not in network, so you shouldn't have gone. It's like, what? Yeah.
Thank you all. How about we take the last question?
This is a coworker, so she's going to ask a hard question.
No, it's not a question. It's more of a statement. So I work with Michael Garrett, and so I work with employers on their employee benefit plans and programs. And one of the things we hear a lot, I mean, is around the formulary and when providers actually I'm sitting in the doctor's office and I need this prescription, the visibility for the provider into my formulary, my plan. How much is this medication going to cost me? Is there an alternative? And that creates a tremendous amount of disruption for me, the purchaser, the patient, If my doctor said I need this one, and then I go to the pharmacy and that's X amount of dollars, when there's the same, you know, concoction of drug that I could have for $10. So just having some visibility and transparency for providers to be able to see into a person's formulary right when they're prescribing.
Real time, yeah.
Real time.
Absolutely. Yeah.
That's so funny that you mentioned that. Yes, we had a retreat with a PET board in January, and the focus was on how that whole thing works, because we were trying to encourage them to create a formulary, which we don't have, but they voted for eventually. But so we had a panel of physicians come up. We had four physicians, two of them were from Kaiser and two of them were not from Kaiser, and it was just striking the difference in their experience. We're like, how does that work? Everything that you just described. And Kaiser docs were like, it's fine. We just like prescribe the things that are on the formulary. And the other docs were like, well, let me tell you, we, you know, the patient goes in and tries to get their prescription and they can't. And so there's this fact, they described it as the fax wars.
Oh, yeah.
Fax wars back and forth. And we all concluded that that industry alone, the healthcare industry alone, is keeping the fax industry alive.
It's true. It's true. And
time
so
for it to go.
So with Kaiser, it is in their regular workflow in their EHR. They don't have to go log on to another thing to find out. They're not going to do that. But if it's right there within their EHR, their workflow, then they can see it. And to Lorian's point, you know, then it can all be part of real time. But it doesn't
that
exist.
Would be a good product.
Yeah, it would.
I'd put that right up there with the single provider directory.
Mm-hmm. And one product already exists called MedSavvy, which allows you to compare all your medication in real time and see what else you can get instead of the costly drug that your provider prescribed. I want to thank you, everyone, and I'll return the mic back to Jessica.
Thank you. You're already clapping. I just thank you so much to the panel, Marissa, Marcia, and Michael. That was fabulous. Tons of information there. Well, funny that you ended on that fax comment, because we just had our last intern leave named Hannah, and she noted that her most embarrassing moment was that somebody had, or she kept saying the F with a phone number at the end, and she was like, why do people keep spelling phone with an F?
Oh.
She could not believe that it was for fax. It blew her mind. So I think you're right. Healthcare is keeping the fax business alive. And also join me in thanking Anil for coming up and joining us as the moderator for today. Again, the surveys are on your chair. We appreciate all feedback. We design our programs around your feedback. There's a bag up on the white counter, if you wouldn't mind dropping it in there on your way out. And thanks again for joining us. Have a great evening.